Hare Krishna. So today I'll discuss on the first and last words of the Bhagavad Gita and how they reflect its message. So the first words of the Bhagavad Gita is Dharma. Of course, the Bhagavad Gita begins with a question by Dhritarashtra. Dhritarashtra vacha dharma kshetre kuru kshetre samaveta yutsavaha mamakaha pandava shaiva kimakurvata sanjaya. So the Dhritarashtra is asking, at the place of dharma, that is Kurukshetra, when my sons and the sons of Pandu assembled, what did they do? So the first word here is dharma. Dharma kshetra, it's a compound word, but within that, the first word that is a part of the Bhagavad Gita is dharma. And if you look at the last verse of the Bhagavad Gita, 18.78, there it states, Sanjay is speaking those last words, and he says, Yatra Yogeshwara Krishna, Yatra Partho Dhanurdhara, Tatra Shreer Vijayo Bhutir, Dhruva Nitir Matir Mama. So, Dhruva, Krishna, Sanjay is saying that wherever there is Krishna, the supreme mystic, and wherever there is Arjuna, the great archer, there will be victory, opulence, strength, and morality. This is my opinion. It's interesting, the last word of the Bhagavad Gita is my opinion. Matir mama. And normally, we would think that if somebody is saying this is my opinion, that makes it subjective. Everybody has their own opinions. And we often say, go to the extent of saying that to have our own opinions can be speculation. We should just repeat Shastra. But it's interesting, the Bhagavad Gita's last word is, it's my opinion. So why does it stress like this, my opinion? In India, there's a common short poster that people put in their homes. They call it Gita Sar, the essence of the Gita. And one of the statements in the Gita Sar is, whatever has happened is good. Whatever is happening is good. Whatever will happen will also be good. Now, I have read the Gita several hundred times, recited it hundreds and hundreds of times. I have never been able to come to any verse which is anywhere similar to this. That whatever has happened is good, whatever is happening is good, whatever will happen will be good. So now, we may say, is that contrary to the Gita's philosophy? Yeah, ultimately Krishna is the well-wisher of everyone. And in that sense, whatever happens, Krishna will orchestrate it for the ultimate good of everyone. So it's not incompatible with the Gita's message. But it is not the Gita's message. The Gita's message centers on not on God's power or God's will. Its center is on human will and on aligning human will with divine will. The purpose of the Gita is not to proclaim God's position. Yes, the Bhagavad Gita does proclaim God's position, but its purpose is not to just to proclaim God's position, it is to transform human disposition. Arjuna is confused at the start of the Gita. And by the end of the Gita, Arjuna's confusion is removed. So the Gita, if we look back at the word dharma, dharma is the first word in the Gita, dharma kshetri. And when Arjuna asks, while surrendering to Krishna, asks the question. What is that question? He says, Karpanya dosho pahata swabhava pruchhami tvam dharma sammoodha chetaha. He says, pruchhami tvam, I am asking you, what is dharma? About what is dharma, I am confused. Sammoodha chetaha. I am bewildered. My consciousness is deluded. So please tell me, what is dharma? And in fact, the Bhagavad Gita is a part of the Mahabharata. And the Mahabharata has a driving question. Each book has a question that drives that book. The Bhagavatam's driving question is, what is the duty of a person about to die? The Ramayana's driving question is, what are the characteristics of an ideal person? The Mahabharata's driving question is, what is dharma? What is dharma? That is the question. And that which is the driving question of the Mahabharata is also the defining question of the Bhagavad Gita. Arjuna is asking, Pruchhami tvam dharma sammoodha cheta. What is dharma? That means that the Bhagavad Gita's focus is on helping us align ourselves with the divine. Now, the word dharma can have many meanings. Sometimes it's translated as religion, sometimes it's translated as duty, and all these are valid contextual meanings. But the underlying sense of the word dharma is that dhru is sustain. So dharma is that which sustains. So the idea of the word, underlying the word dharma, is that there is an order that sustains the universe, that there is an order that sustains all of existence. And to the extent we play our part in that order, then we harmonize with it. So the whole vision of the Bhagavad Gita is to give us a big picture of reality so that we can understand our place and our purpose within that reality. Say, when we are going traveling by a plane, at that time we worry whether we reach on time or not. We are concerned whether we have our boarding pass or ID proof. But we don't worry when we are boarding a plane, is there enough fuel in the plane or not? Is the pilot of the plane sober or is the pilot of the plane drunk? We don't worry about these things. Why not? Because there is a whole system that will take care of those things. In our flight journey, we have to play our part. And there is a whole system that will take care of the rest of the things. Similarly, the Bhagavad Gita explains that there is a whole of which we are a part. And we have to play the part of the part. And the whole will take care of the whole. So that there is an order in the big picture, that is true. That is definitely the message of the Gita. But we have free will. And we are meant to use our free will properly to harmonize with the whole. So if we consider the word dharma, it occurs many, many times in the Gita. But the word dharma is, when it is used in this context, when Arjuna is saying, Pruchhami tvam dharma sammoodha chetaha, I am confused about what am I meant to do. So at that time, the whole Gita is spoken to guide Arjuna towards the right course of action. So dharma in this context simply means the right course of action. So the right course of action means that action which will harmonize us with the whole. And if we see the Bhagavad Gita ends, the last one of the concluding verses that Krishna speaks to Arjuna is, O Arjuna, you deliberate and now you decide what you want to do. Vimrishaita dasheshena yathechasi tatha kuru. As is your desire, so you do. But before doing that, deliberate. So the Bhagavad Gita does not deny or suppress our desires, but it gives us knowledge by which we can choose our desire wisely. We can act wisely according to a proper desire. So we could say the Bhagavad Gita is like a map. And it is a map for life. The map can tell us where to go, but it is for us to go there. If we follow the map properly and if it is a reliable map, the map will take us to the destination. So at the end of the Bhagavad Gita, towards the end, 18.63, Krishna tells Arjuna, this is what I have told you now. Deliberate on it and do as you desire. So the Bhagavad Gita is actually an appeal to to human intelligence and an acknowledgement of human independence. It's not giving commandments, do this, don't do this. There are of course verses like that, but the Bhagavad Gita's mood is not to give out commandments. The Bhagavad Gita's mood is to outline choices and consequences. If you do this, this will happen. If you do this, this will happen. Now you decide what you want to do. So it is, in that sense, it's like a map. A map tells us, okay, if you go take this road, you'll go here. If you take this road, you'll go here. So it gives choices and consequences. And the success of the Bhagavad Gita is seen 10 verses later in 18.73, where Arjuna says that yes, my doubt is dispelled and nashto moha smriti labdha tvat prasadan maya achyuta stito smigata sandeha karishye vachanam tava. So he says, karishye vachanam tava, I will do your will. By hearing this message, my doubt has been dispelled, my illusion has gone, my memory has been restored, my composure has been restored, and the result of all this is, I will do your will. So the Bhagavad Gita, some people say, why is God telling a peace-loving person to fight? Yes, there is a fight in the context of the Bhagavad Gita, but if you see, the Bhagavad Gita hardly ever talks about the war. In the 700 verses of the Gita, there are barely 25-30 verses which contain the references to the war. Apart from the first chapter, which is the description, the most of the references to the war come only in the 11th chapter, where the Vishwarupa is revealed. But apart from that 11th chapter, in the 8th chapter, Krishna says, Tasmat sarveshu kaleshu mam anusmara yudhyacha. You remember me and fight. After that, there is not a single reference to the war at all. So the Bhagavad Gita is not a call to war. It is a call to harmony with the divine. And that's why when Arjuna responds, he doesn't say, oh Krishna, I'll fight the war. He says, Krishna, I will do your will. The stress of the Bhagavad Gita is not to fight a war. The stress of the Bhagavad Gita is that the human will should be harmonized with the divine will. And in the exceptional situation of the Bhagavad Gita, that harmonization of the human will with the divine will requires fighting a war. But fighting a war is incidental to the message of the Gita. And now, so the Gita is, we could say, a two-layered conversation. One layer is the inner layer between Krishna and Arjuna. And that conversation ends with 18.73, where Arjuna says, I will do your will. The second layered conversation is between Dhritarashtra and Sanjay. So Dhritarashtra is asking, what happened? That's 1.1. And 18.78, Sanjay is saying, but where there is Krishna, where there is Arjuna, there will be victory. That is my opinion. So, this indicates that the outer level conversation, which is between Sanjay and Dhritarashtra, is also successful. How is it successful? That at one level, this Arjuna was confused and Arjuna's confusion was resolved. Now Dhritarashtra was attached, but Dhritarashtra's attachment didn't go away. Dhritarashtra's attachment still remained. So then how was this conversation successful? The success is that Sanjay becomes completely convinced about Krishna's divinity. Sanjay becomes convinced that those who align with Krishna, they are going to be successful. So when the Bhagavad Gita concludes with Matir Mama, this is my opinion. What that signifies is not the subjectivity of this is just one person's opinion and he's saying that. But it is conveying that the person who was a transmitter of the Gita, that person has also become convinced that harmonizing with the divine is the most auspicious course of action. And that's why he's saying, where there is Krishna and where there is Arjuna, there, there will be victory. Now, we could analyze this verse a little bit more, and we could say that actually, why is Arjuna needed? Isn't it? Wherever there is Krishna, there will be victory. So, why do we need Arjuna at all? Isn't it God? Yet wherever there is Krishna, he is the Lord or the Goddess of fortune. And he will bring fortune over there. He will bring victory over there. So, where there is Narayan, Lakshmi is there with him. So, where there is Krishna, there will be victory anyway. So, why does the Bhagavad Gita stress not just Yatra Yogeshwara Krishna, but Yatra Partho Dhanurdharaha? That where there is Krishna and where there is Arjuna, there will be victory. Just where there is Krishna, there is going to be victory. But the point of the Bhagavad Gita, as I said, is not to proclaim God's position. It is to transform human disposition. So, by saying that where there is Krishna and where there is Arjuna, there is victory. What he is conveying is that those human beings who harmonize with the divine, they will be victorious. In the context of the Gita, he is not openly telling that, oh, your son is going to be defeated. Your son's party is going to be defeated and destroyed. He's not telling that openly. He's not that blunt. When people's emotions are involved, there has to be a little sensitivity. Even when a harsh truth is to be conveyed, we convey it in a way that is as less painful as possible. That's a figure of speech called euphemism. Where he says, he's died. We say, he's passed away. He's gone to the next world. There are many ways in which we soften the truth. And that's just a matter of politeness, sensitivity, which is good. So, in the past, say, people would be called crippled or handicapped. Now, we may use the word specially abled or special needs people. So, that's just a way of sensitively speaking. So, Sanjay in the hierarchy, Dhritarashtra is the king, Sanjay is a servant. So, Sanjay cannot tell, your son is going to be killed. So, indirectly he tells, after hearing the Bhagavad Gita, I am convinced. Matir Mama, here it conveys not the subjectivity of just an individual opinion, but it conveys the conviction of a hearer of the Bhagavad Gita on hearing the Bhagavad Gita. Now, he is hearing in the sense that he is seeing the conversation, he is hearing it and he is repeating it. So, he becomes convinced. So, in the context of the Gita, it means that, O Dhritarashtra, where there is Krishna, where there is Arjuna, there will be victory. That means, your son is not going to be victorious. It's indirectly conveyed over there. And when he says, this is my opinion, that means, by hearing the Gita, by remembering the Gita, whoever does so, they will become convinced that harmonizing with Krishna is the most auspicious course of action. Because by that, victory will come for everyone. Victory will come for whoever follows that course of action. Sometimes when we share the message of the Gita, at that time, we may distribute books, we may give classes, we may talk with people at a one-to-one level. And many times, people may not be transformed. People may not take up the process of bhakti. But even if they don't take up that process, still, the very fact that we have spoken that message, that will purify us. That will elevate our consciousness. If we have the mood of I am the doer, and not just I am the doer, that I am the sole doer, and I am going to transform this person's heart by my erudition, by my eloquence. I am going to convince this person. I am going to convert this person. Then, if that is our mood, then if somebody doesn't become transformed, then we feel it's a failure. And if Sanjay had this mood, then Sanjay would have become disheartened. But the previous two verses, 18.78 is the conclusion, 18.76 and 77, both of them describe Sanjay's being thrilled. Rajan samsmritya samsmritya rupamatya adbhutam harehe vismayo me mahan rajan rushyami cha punah punah tat samsmritya samsmritya samvadamim adbhutam keshavarjunayo punyam rushyami cha muhurmuho. So rushyami means I'm thrilled. Again and again I'm thrilled. Every moment I'm thrilled. And he is saying, what is thrill? What is causing that thrill? 76 and 77 verses tell two distinct things. 76 verse says that just remembering the conversation of the Gita is bringing thrill to me. Rajan samsut samvita samvadam imam adbhutam. Keshav Arjuna yopunyam. This is an extraordinary conversation. Remembering it, I'm getting thrilled. And then he says, by remembering the form of Keshava, rupam atyadbhutam hare, the extraordinary form of Hari, that is filling me with thrill. Now that form of Hari can refer to just the form of Krishna as the chariot of Arjuna, and they can also refer to the Vishwarupa that Krishna has shown during the Bhagavad Gita's narration. So basically, remembering the Gita and remembering the object of the Gita. The center, the object, the purpose of the Gita is Krishna. So remembering the Gita and remembering the center of the Gita, Krishna, both of these can fill us with a thrilling sense of ecstasy. And thus, when we are trying to serve Krishna, there are different aspects or different levels of success. There is an external success, there is the internal success. The external success is when we are trying to do a service, whether that service gets done properly or not. We go out for book distribution, whether people take books or not. We give a class, whether people start practicing bhakti after that or not. There's an external result. The internal result is that we ourselves become purified. We ourselves become attracted to Krishna. So, we could say that 18.73 and 18.78, they demonstrate these two results. So, for Arjuna, his confusion was removed. The war is not yet won. Actually, the war is to begin still. But most often for us, when we have to do something which is difficult, it is that the mind tends to make the thing appear much more difficult than it needs to be. Often, when we have to do something difficult, we drag our feet about it. I'll do it later. Maybe somebody else will do it. We keep dragging our feet. Why? Because the mind makes it appear, yeah, this is going to be too difficult. This is not going to be possible for me at all. But there are things which are disastrous and there are things which are uncomfortable. But the mind, by its exaggeration, makes even the uncomfortable seem disastrous. Hey, I just can't do this. So suppose there's a festival on which you have to fast. Now fasting is uncomfortable, it's unpleasant. But that which is uncomfortable, the mind makes it appear as if it's unbearable. For Arjuna, fighting against the Kauravas, which include his own relatives and elders, that is unpleasant. But Arjuna's mind, if we see the first verse of the first chapter of the Bhagavad Gita, Arjuna's mind starts catastrophizing everything. Oh, all dynasties will be destroyed. Our society will crumble. Immorality will arise. And because all this will happen, we will cause the war, will make this happen, and thus we will have to go to hell. So it is definitely, war is a very unpleasant, very unfortunate. If possible, we should always avoid war. That's true. But Arjuna's mind had catastrophized the whole situation. And Krishna said, no. The message of the Bhagavad Gita pacified him. So just the hearing the Gita, what happened? Arjuna won the inner war. The inner war was where his emotion had sabotaged his determination. He had come there to fight the war. But his emotion, no, I can't do this. This is terrible. So when his emotion had sabotaged his determination, he lost the inner war almost. He gave up fighting. But then the Bhagavad Gita helped him to win the inner war. And so the success in the inner war is demonstrated in 18.73, that Arjuna won internally. And that Arjuna was going to win externally, that is predicted in the second war, in the second conclusion of the Gita, 18.78. So for Arjuna, there's an internal success, there's an external success. He got the internal success simply by hearing the Gita. And the external success would follow when he would fight the war and he will win the war. For Sanjay also, there is an internal success and there is an external success. The external success was that Dhritarashtra was attached and Dhritarashtra gave up his partisanship, gave up his partiality towards his own sons. That didn't happen. So in that sense, the external conversation of the Gita was unsuccessful. But at an internal level, he became cheerful, he became blissful. He became filled with a thrilling sense of ecstasy. And in that sense, the Gita's conversation was successful for him. So for us, when we are practicing bhakti, if we understand that in our practice of bhakti, there are both these things. There's internal success and there's external success. And the external success may sometimes not come, but the internal success will always come. And that gives us security, that gives us confidence, that gives us the impetus to move on. The world often is unfair because the world judges us outside in. Somebody may study very diligently for an exam, but if just before the exam they fall sick, then they fail in the exam and they get nothing with it. So in the world, when we function, unless the external results manifest, people don't value. So sometimes the external results are not in our control. Despite our best efforts, we may not get the results. Sometimes we may function in a very reasonable, polite, courteous, helpful way, and still people will misunderstand us. People will blame us, people will criticize us, people will lampoon us. It can be very painful. Because when we are functioning in the world sees us outside in. And because it sees us outside in, the results are not in our control. And so, despite our best efforts, we may be judged negatively and unfairly. However, Krishna sees us inside out. Krishna sees our consciousness, Krishna sees our endeavors, and Krishna sees our mood of service. And that is demonstrated most graphically in 9.26 when Krishna says, Patram pushpam phalam toyam yome bhaktya prayachati tadaham bhakti uparitam ashnami prayatatmanaha. See, even if you offer me just a fruit or a flower, I will accept it. Now, if you consider the battlefield of the Bhagavad Gita, battlefield of the Bhagavad Gita is being spoken. Arjuna is a mighty warrior with a bow and arrow. We try to visualize him offering a fruit or a flower. He has to offer Krishna arrows from his Gandiva as a war. But Krishna is stating over here that even something as simple as this, if it is done in a mood of devotion, that will satisfy me. So the Bhagavad Gita actually empowers us by revealing that inner success is always in our hands. We can't always do our service in terms of getting the result. That's not in our control. But we can always maintain a service attitude. And if that attitude of service is maintained, that is our success. The Bhagavad Gita did not miraculously cause Arjuna's enemies to disappear. Bhagavad Gita is spoken by God and God reveals His majesty also. And within that He shows the Virat Rupa, how enemies are going to be destroyed. But still, after that, Arjuna had to fight a war. And it was not an easy war. 18 days were fierce fighting he had to do. So in that sense, what did the Bhagavad Gita do for Arjuna? The Bhagavad Gita gave him a confidence that no matter what opposition, what adversities may come, you know, Krishna is with him. And Krishna will help him to overcome the obstacles. Machitta sarva durgani mat prasada tarishyasi. Whatever obstacles come, by my grace, you will cross over all those obstacles. So the Bhagavad Gita did not remove the external obstacles in Arjuna's path, but it removed the internal obstacle, his own confusion. And it revealed to him that the internal success of harmonizing with Krishna, of maintaining a determined service attitude towards Krishna, that was always in his hands. Now, if we expand the context of the Gita and see how that applies to us, for all of us, also, one of the biggest challenges in life is making decisions. If we look at our life is determined largely by the decisions that we make. Our life is determined largely by when we are at crossroads, when we are at intersections, what decisions do we make? Every moment we are making decisions. Right now I am speaking, I am deciding, should I be taking this class in this direction or this direction? Right now when you are hearing, you are also deciding, consciously or subconsciously, should I pay attention to this point or should I think of something else? So we all make decisions constantly, moment after moment after moment. But there are some moments in our life which are defining. The decisions at those times, they shape the trajectory of our entire life. Going back to the earlier metaphor of the map, every moment that we are driving, it matters. At any moment, we may veer off course and we may hit the pavement, or we may go off the road and there may be a field or a forest, or there may be a cliff from which we may slide off. So in one sense, at every moment on the road, there is caution required when we are driving. But normally there is a well-defined road, we will move along that road. And when we come to a crossroad, when we come to an intersection, should I go here or should I go there? So in conceptualization, we could say, every moment when we are driving, we are making decisions. But in terms of major effect, major consequences, say when there is a intersection, here or here, that's the time when we have to make decisions. And we may go completely off track and we may go away from our destination if we make a wrong choice. So what does the Bhagavad Gita tell us for us when we are making decisions? It says the first decision we always make is that I want to serve Krishna. If we keep that decision, that resolution strong in our mind, I want to serve Krishna always, no matter what happens, then that internal resolution will give us connection with Krishna. And that connection will give us a sense of clarity, a sense of direction. What should I do? Sometimes we have to make external decisions. And while making those external decisions, okay, should I take this job or should I take that job? Should I stay in this place or should I stay in that place? Should I join this ashram or should I join that ashram? Should I marry this person or should I marry that person? Should I take initiation from this guru or should I take initiation from that guru? There are so many decisions we have to make even when we are sadhakas in our spiritual life. And sometimes these decisions, they can confuse us so much. That we just become discouraged, we become disheartened. But the Bhagavad Gita tells us, Prabhupada writes in a purport also, a devotee may be perplexed, but a devotee is never discouraged. Perplexed means we don't know what to do. Discouraged means we don't feel like doing anything. So a devotee is never discouraged in the sense that devotee never loses the spirit of serving Krishna. Just as Sanjay, although he could not succeed externally in terms of changing Dhritarashtra's heart, but just by remembering Krishna's message and remembering Krishna's form, he became enlivened. Similarly, if internally we stay determined that I am going to serve Krishna no matter what happens, then we will march forward. We will be guided from within. We'll be guided from within. As long as we maintain the inner connection, there will be some perplexity, this or that. But if you focus primarily on maintaining that internal connection, let me study the Shastra, let me chant the holy names, let me pray to Krishna. Let me not become disheartened in doing these things. And not just pray to Krishna to solve the problem. Pray to Krishna to show the path ahead. And then after praying to Krishna, what do? We take small steps. The Mam Anusmara Yudhyacha, that is the two aspects, that is the internal action and the external action. Internally remember me, externally do your duty, Krishna tells Arjuna. So in our situation, we internally pray to Krishna, connect ourselves with Krishna, and then externally we do what we can in the situation. Okay. Sometimes when we are planning our life, we may say, okay, it appears as if I will do this. We make a long-term plan for our life. It's like a road ahead. It's night, but there are street lights by which we can see the road ahead and we can go ahead. But sometimes the lights go off. It becomes pitch dark and we can't see the road ahead at all. At that time, our service attitude will become like our flashlight. If we are walking along a dark road, we don't have the power to turn on the street lights. But we can turn on our own flashlight. Our own phone's flashlight we turn on. That will not show the full way ahead. But that can show us one step ahead. And we take one step ahead and the flashlight will show the next step ahead. We take the next step ahead, the flashlight will show the next step ahead. So similarly for us, if we have a strong service attitude, Krishna, you are my Lord, I am your servant. And this is what I am going to do. I want to serve you. Please guide me how I can serve you. If we keep that resolute determination to serve Krishna, then we'll take one step forward, one step forward, one step forward. And we can cover a significant distance simply by taking these small steps. And eventually the lights will come back. And the lights will come back and we will see the path ahead clearly. So, just as Arjuna was confused, what is dharma? And Krishna revealed to him that what is dharma for him? Just surrender to Krishna. Karishye vachanam tava. I will do your will. So, rather than obsessing too much on external situation, this or that, we focus on changing our internal disposition, increasing our conviction to serve Krishna and to do small steps in moving forward in that service. And when we are taking decisions, life doesn't come with the guarantee of taking right decisions. No matter how much we decide, no matter how much we pray, no matter how much we deliberate, no matter how much we consult others, no matter how much we try to analyze the long-term consequences, still, sometimes it may happen that we may take a wrong turn. We may take a wrong decision. But Krishna is so expert that even if we commit some mistake, even if we take a wrong turn, Krishna will still guide us back on the right direction. So Krishna, actually Krishna's plan is so all-encompassing that it accommodates even our mistakes. That even if we take some wrong turns, Krishna's plan accommodates that. We'll conclude with this example. That I was giving the example of how we have the Bhagavad Gita is like a map. The Bhagavad Gita reveals to us Krishna's will. So say if we have Google Map, which is guiding us, and says, okay, take the left turn. And then if somehow at that time we take the right turn. Now what does Google Map do at that time? It immediately reroutes. It says, okay, it reroutes. It says, okay, now from here you go this way. If we take another wrong turn, again it will reroute and again it will tell us the path. Now even if we take 100 wrong turns, still the map will reroute and show us the right way. Now the wrong turns are not inconsequential. Each wrong turn means that we are maybe going further away and it will take that much time to get to the destination. So it's not that the wrong turns are inconsequential. They have consequences. But no wrong turn is fatal. No wrong turn means that we will never get to the destination. So So like that, Krishna is the ultimate Google. He guides us toward the right direction, and even if we take a wrong direction, even if we take a wrong turn, Krishna reroutes and guides us again and again and again. And wherever we are, Krishna is with us, guiding us forwards. And that hope, that confidence that Krishna will reveal the path ahead for us in our life if we just keep serving Him and we just keep doing what we can with our God-given intelligence, Krishna will guide us forward. That conviction in divine benevolence is conveyed through the Gita's concluding word, Matir Mama. So Sanjay is also convinced, just as Krishna, Arjuna is convinced that by doing Krishna's will, that is auspicious for me, Karishye Vachnam Tava. Similarly, Sanjay is convinced, Matir Mama, it's my opinion. That means Sanjay doesn't have to do any action immediately. Arjuna has to do an action. Arjuna has to fight a war. So for Sanjay, it's his conviction. Yes. Whoever is with Krishna, that person will be successful. That person will be victorious. So similarly, if we, by hearing the Bhagavad Gita, understand, I always want to be with Krishna. I always want to serve Krishna. I always want to stay connected with Krishna. Then even if life throws many distractions in our path, and even if we temporarily get distracted, we will get realigned, we'll get connected with Krishna once again, and Krishna will guide us towards auspiciousness. Just as there's a victory for Arjuna because he was with Krishna, similarly for us, in the ultimate analysis, there'll be victory. We will overcome whatever obstacles life may send our way. We will attain the ultimate victory of reuniting with Krishna in our heart internally by our devotional connection and in His abode eternally by our attaining that abode at the end of our life. So, I'll summarize. I spoke about the significance of the Bhagavad Gita's message as is revealed in its first and the last words. So, the first word dharma, the last word matir mama. Dharma refers not just to duty or religion, but it refers to the action that harmonizes us with the order that sustains the universe. And that action will sustain us in our position. So just like for a passenger in a plane, doesn't have to worry about the fuel or the state of the pilot, but he has to worry about doing his part. So when we play the part of the part, the whole will take care of the whole. And the subject, the matir mama, my opinion, which Sanjay says at the end, that is not indicative of subjectivity, but that is indicative of that he is also convinced about the benefit, about the auspiciousness of harmonizing with Krishna. The Gita's purpose is not just to proclaim God's position, it is to transform man's disposition. And that it does through its philosophical message. So Gita acknowledges human independence and it appeals to human intelligence. Deliberate and do as you desire. The Gita is a two-layered conversation, first between Krishna and Arjuna, which ends in 18.73 with Arjuna recognizing that I want to do your will. So when Arjuna has this confusion, what is dharma? The word dharma comes at the start of the Gita in 1.1, and in Arjuna's question, which drives the message of Gita, is Prichhami Tvam Dharma Sammodachit. I ask you, what is dharma? And that is the driving question of the Mahabharata also. What is dharma? And he understands by the end of the Gita that harmonizing with the will of Krishna is our dharma. Serving Krishna is our dharma. And the Gita demonstrates the external success that Arjuna is going, the internal success of Arjuna is that his confusion is replaced by determination. And external success is going to come to him as is told by the prophecy of Sanjay. And where there is Krishna and where there is Arjuna, there will be victory. So in a euphemistic way, he is telling Dhritarashtra that your son is not going to be successful. And the opposite party is going to be successful. And the Gita doesn't say just where there is God, there will be success. Because there will be success. But the point of the Gita is to get man, get humanity to harmonize with divinity. So that is the internal success for Sanjay. That when he says Matir Mama, that means he has become convinced that by remembering Krishna's message and remembering Krishna's form, he will be joyful, he will be enlivened with ecstasy. He does not get the external success in the sense that he can't transform Dhritarashtra's heart. Similarly, we may not get external success in our services. And the world sometimes judges unfairly because it sees us only in terms of our capacity to get the results, which sometimes are not in our power to get. The world sees us outside in, but Krishna sees us inside out. If we internally maintain the determination to serve Krishna, in Krishna's eyes we are successful. And he will take us through whatever difficulties we are having towards the ultimate success. So, when Arjuna says, Krishna, I surrender to you, that indicates that the Gita's message has enabled him to win the internal war, wherein his emotion had attacked his determination. So for us, when we have to do something which is difficult, the mind makes the uncomfortable seem unbearable. But when we hear the Gita's message, we understand, this is not that bad, I can do it. So the Gita can boost our internal determination. And externally, whatever obstacles will come, it's not that Krishna will remove the obstacles, but Krishna will give us the strength to go beyond those obstacles. Our life is determined primarily by the decisions that we make. Every moment we are making decisions, but certain moments are like the intersection in our life journey. That time the decisions are consequential. So Krishna guides us in those making those decisions. If we make the decision that I always want to serve you. So instead of obsessed worrying too much about whether to do this or do that in the externals, we can focus more on strengthening our internal connection with Krishna. And when the external street lights go away, there's too much confusion about what to do, where to go ahead, things go wrong externally, at that time we can turn on our internal flashlight. Krishna, how can I serve you? And when we tell Krishna, Karishye Vachanam Tav, I will do your will, Krishna, then that flashlight will show us small, small steps ahead. And eventually we'll go through that dark phase. And ultimately, the success of the Gita is that it will infuse within us this conviction to always keep serving him, Krishna. And internally, by such service, we'll become more and more connected with him. And we'll become absorbed in him. We will live in him while we're in this world. And externally, at the end of our life, we will attain Krishna. And thus, the success that is prophesied at the end of the Gita, when humanity unites with divinity, then humanity attains the supreme success. That is, we rise to the eternal abode of Krishna. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna. So, Adhaniko, yes, from.
When you were mentioning the world sees us outside in, Krishna sees us inside out. So, could you just give an example? And were you referring to the point that the way the world sees us results in us judging ourselves, whereas when Krishna sees from the inside out, there's more nourishment, confidence, acceptance, because Krishna accepts us with love. So, when you're referring to the world seeing us from outside in, can you just unpack that a little?
Yeah, right. So when I said that the world sees us outside in, what does it mean? If we consider Srila Prabhupada, for 40 years, when he was trying to share Krishna Bhakti in India, he had practically no success to show. So from the world's perspective, all his efforts had failed. But from Krishna's perspective, that he had been serving Krishna so determinedly, that itself was a success. And in the last 11 years of his life, the success manifested. So from the world's perspective, if we can say from Indian's perspective, when Prabhupada was just an unknown Swami with no followers or no influence in the material sense, Indians did not pay much attention to Prabhupada. When he came back with Western followers, at that time, this must be a great Swami, he has made Western people his disciples. Western people are following him. We also want to find out what it is. So at that time, the world started appreciating, India started appreciating Prabhupada. So the world will look for material results. And of course, we also strive to get material results for Krishna, no doubt. But sometimes the material results may not come. So, the world sees outside in means, the first thing that the world sees is, when they look at people, okay, how wealthy a person is, what is the position of a person, is what we see. Now, sometimes some people may, we look at extra, the world sees the appearance of a person, but a person may look very impressive, may look very wealthy, very attractive, but their heart may be quite malicious, quite selfish. So for us, in our practice of life, when we are going through various situations, sometimes it may appear as if we have endeavored and we have no result to show. But now Prabhupada also said, phalena parichayate. Prabhupada, a tree is known by its fruit. But then what was the fruit that Prabhupada was looking for? Prabhupada sometimes says, if you distribute a lot of books, that will please me. Prabhupada encouraged devotees to, in a competitive spirit, to do a lot of service. But there is that famous conversation when devotees ask Prabhupada, what pleases you the most? And Prabhupada said, if you love Krishna, that pleases me the most. So the phala that Prabhupada wanted ultimately for all of us to develop was that we develop love for Krishna. So even if in our services, we don't get any external results, at that time we don't have to become discouraged. If we have maintained a service attitude and we have done what we can in those situations, then we are on the progressive spiritual path, even if no progress is seen externally. Was the answer? Yes.
Okay.
Yes. Yes, ma'am.
Thank you, Prabhupada. You mentioned Arjuna considering his consequences, and this is so important. I pray this is an important question. As part of my initiation vows, I added no speculation to my gambling. Sharing my good day of black, so in that way. But it was one of those pivotal decisions to stick to that. So my point of clarification in chapter 2, when Arjuna says, I shall not fight, he's kind of entrapped, is that consideration of consequence, mental speculation is something we should avoid. The I guess the point that's contrary to this, if we were to not consider consequences and act rather not whimsically, but act without proper due consideration, you know, you have this kind of might fly off the handle, make improper decisions.
Okay.
So how do we balance this and mental speculation?
Okay.
Selfish,
yeah, it's good. So, we are told we should not speculate, but at the same time, we have to consider consequences of our actions. So, how can we consider the consequences without speculating? Certain words have certain connotations. And the word speculate, in our context, in our bhakti, in our movement, has acquired a negative connotation. Say, for example, the word motivation. In the outside world, motivational speaker. It's kind of a good thing, okay, a person goes on, motivates people. But in our context, we say that we should practice unmotivated devotional service. So if somebody is motivated, you say, why are you selfish? We say when we are motivated means, you're selfishly motivated. Don't be motivated like that. So, in our context, some words may acquire some negative connotations. So, I would say that the word speculation is a word which is tinged with negativity. So, rather than focusing so much on the word, let's focus on the concept. Word is like, if we consider a suitcase, if the suitcase is a object which we want to carry and the handle is the object with which we carry the suitcase. So the handle is like the term and the concept is like the suitcase. So currently the word speculation has become very negatively tinged. So let's put the word aside for the time being and look at the concept. The concept is that we all have been given intelligence by God and we are meant to use our intelligence in properly. Properly means, first of all, the Bhagavad Gita, as I said, is an appeal to human intelligence. So it's not that the Bhagavad Gita asks us to reject our intelligence. Rather, it asks us to use our intelligence to surrender to Krishna. Now, when we use our intelligence, the very nature of life is that we, some situations are clear to us and many situations are unclear to us. Now, when the situations are unclear, sometimes it's possible for us to consult someone who knows what is, who knows things clearly, and then we take a decision. So, but sometimes it's just that the life is so dynamic and we have to take certain decisions, we may not be able to consult someone at that. So then based on our gut feeling, based on our hunch, based on our intelligence, based on our instinct, we may take certain decisions. So Prabhupada was, so in that case, is that speculation? Not necessarily, it can be, but it is, sometimes we don't know the answer to a particular question. Then it is good, we can say that, okay, I don't know the answer, I'll consult my seniors and I'll tell the answer. But sometimes we may not know the answer, but we can give some pointers to the answer. Okay, this is what my understanding is. So there are many, many situations in life where we will not get a direct shastric injunction to make a decision. So then we have to use shastra and understand the principles of shastra and apply those principles in our life. When we talk about, we should always follow dharma. Now dharma is not like some infinite set of law codes. And every situation that we face in our life, then we Google in our head, okay, this situation, this situation, this situation. What should I do in this situation? No, dharma is not like that. It is basically, we understand the principle that I am meant to serve Krishna. And how best can I serve Krishna in this situation? If we consider the song that Srila Prabhupada wrote when he came to America on the Boston Pier, while he was looking at the American skyline, he wrote the Markini Bhagavad Dharma, preaching the Bhagavatam. And there he says, Ache kichu karja tabe ei anumane, nahe keno ani bena ei ugrastane. My dear Lord, you must have some purpose because of which you have brought me here. Otherwise, why would you bring me here? It's interesting when he's saying this, Ache kichu karja tabe ei anumane. The word anuman means, this is my guess. Now you could give a negative spin to this and say, this is my speculation. Now we don't use the negative word, but the point is, it is not that Prabhupada, when he came to America, he knew everything about everything. Oh, I'm going to go here and I'm going to meet this person, and this person is going to become a devotee, and I'm going to go there and there's we're going to open a center. Prabhupada tried various things. Some things worked, some things that didn't work, he tried something else. So he, when he's using the word anuman, he's not saying that in the sense of speculation. He's saying that, okay, there is a certain amount of uncertainty when we are functioning in this world. So there is practical uncertainty about what I'm going to do. But Prabhupada, the philosophical certainty he has. There is a purpose of Krishna. That's why he has brought me here. So for us to use our intelligence in Krishna's service is vital. And using our intelligence to try to understand things, using our intelligence to try to figure out a course of action that we can take forwards, that is not speculation. If our purpose is to serve Krishna, then using our intelligence to further that purpose is not speculation. When we use our intelligence to question that purpose itself, when we use our intelligence to question the purpose of serving Krishna itself, then that becomes speculation. Prabhupada to talk about the difference between philosophical speculation and mental speculation. So mental speculation is that we question the conclusion of scripture itself. Philosophical speculation is we accept the conclusion of scripture, but we try to analyze to make sense. How does it make sense to me? So that sort of philosophical speculation is encouraged. In the 14th chapter of the Bhagavad Gita in a purport, Prabhupada says, if we study this chapter of the Bhagavad Gita, then by philosophical conclusion, we can come to the conclusion of devotional service. So we don't have to become paranoid about not speculating. In the sense, if speculation means that we stop using our intelligence, that is not good. But what it means, no speculation means, we don't use our intelligence to challenge the conclusion of scripture. Challenge the conclusion that Krishna is my Lord, I am meant to serve Him. But specifically how to serve Krishna in what situation, for that we need to use our intelligence. And that is not speculation, that is simply intelligence used in Krishna's service. So there is Anuman. Anuman is just guessing. But when Anuman is directed according to Shastra, then it is called as Vichar. Vichar is philosophical contemplation, or what we call is philosophical speculation. And that is vital for us to internalize the philosophy. When I hear the philosophy, how do I make sense of it? For that we have to use our intelligence, we have to use our experience, we have to use our analytical skills. And that's why sometimes when we hear a class, we may have a particular question and one devotee may answer the question in one way, another devotee may answer in a different way. So the third devotee may answer in a different way. And then the third devotee answers, hey, that makes sense to me. So it's not that the previous two devotees' questions and answers were wrong. He says, this is what makes sense to us. So if we use the intelligence to defy the purpose of serving Krishna, then that is speculation. But if we use the intelligence to further the purpose of serving Krishna, then that is the harmonizing of the intelligence with devotion. That is not speculation. Does that answer your question? Thank you. Do we have time or? Yes. What did you say? Half?
It's okay. Thank you.
Oh, okay.
Hare Krishna. I was thinking more in the theme of what Dushya Prabhu brought up. That the world sees outside in and Krishna sees us inside out.
Mm.
So, regarding Krishna sees inside out, there is no doubt about that philosophical concept, that attitude of Krishna. But being sadhakas, how much we should be applying that concept in our lives, because there is a tendency to make ourselves not accountable by convincing us ourselves artificially that Krishna sees inside out, I don't have to worry about being accountable to anybody of this world because Krishna knows my heart. I mean, genuinely, I'm completely pure, that it makes sense.
Hmm.
But.
Okay, I get what you're saying. So, can Krishna sees us inside out be misused to avoid accountability to others, saying that Krishna knows my heart? So, you don't judge me. I don't care for what you think about me. No, we serve Krishna in various ways. And one way we serve Krishna is by connecting with devotees. So, rather than seeing bhakti as one activity alone, we see bhakti as a constellation of activities. And association of devotees, associating with devotees, having good relationship with devotees is an integral part of bhakti. Guhyam akhyati pruchyati. That is a very important limb of bhakti. In fact, among the six loving exchanges, I'd say what actually will give us longevity in our bhakti is our capacity to do these, taking prasadam, honoring prasadam, giving and taking prasadam. That's something which we'll do anyway. That is something, it is important. Giving gifts, taking gifts, that's wonderful. That's also good. But actually the capacity to connect at the level of hearts, that is the most important aspect of devotion. So, it is the tendency of the conditioned mind is to take one point and make it into everything. That can happen in material life, that can happen in spiritual life also. So, Krishna sees inside out. If I absolutize this point, and therefore I don't care for what the world says, I don't care for what devotees think about me, that is inappropriate. Because bhakti involves all these things also. But there can be situations in our life when even devotees misunderstand us. Devotees are unable to, somehow, devotees are not able to help us. So at that time, we should not let that dishearten us and make us give up our relationship with Krishna. So it's like there is a principle of manas puja, that we can worship Krishna in our mind. Now, manas puja is not a replacement for actual puja. In the normal situation is that we don't worship Krishna in the mind, we actually worship Krishna practically by serving Him. But in exceptional situations, when we are not able to serve Krishna externally, at that time, we serve Krishna internally, we worship Krishna in our heart, and Krishna accepts that service. We have the example in the Bhagavatam that when Vasudeva was in jail, he couldn't give any charity at the time of the birth of Krishna. But as soon as he was released from the jail, he gave abandoned charity. So the intention of the heart needs to be expressed through the actions in the world. But if somehow circumstances don't allow us to do the action, then we can say that Krishna is satisfied with the intention. It is that, suppose we are doing some service for Krishna, and say we are cooking for Krishna, and then if we are careless and we make a mess of the cooking, and then we say Krishna sees inside out, you know, Krishna is satisfied with my intention. No, we want quality in the external also. But somehow if something goes wrong, at that time we don't become disheartened. So this is not, say Krishna sees inside out, is not a rationalization for external irresponsibility or external unaccountability. It is primarily a recognition that bhakti is not just about externals alone. But then bhakti is not just about internals alone also. Prabhupada translated bhakti as devotional service, not just as devotion. So devotion refers to the internal mood, service refers to the external action. So just as we shouldn't, the material world may reduce people to their externals. Some people may reduce bhakti just to the internals. Bhakti is just sentiment. Prabhupada writes in the introduction of instruction, devotion is not sentimental ecstasy, is not sentimental speculation or imaginative ecstasy. Its substance is practical service. So the point Krishna sees inside out is meant to give us strength when the externals are not possible. But it is not meant to rationalize not caring for the externals or not doing the externals at all. Does that address your question? Thank you. Should we stop here? Okay, yeah. Sound like this.
Just a quick appreciation for it. Really, I was really impressed by this point that you made about the Sanjaya. And just looking at the Bhagavad Gita from his perspective, I've never been able to do that before. Like to see that actually his success was there because he heard the conversation and he became fully convinced and again, actually thrilled by recounting the memory of the conversation of Arjuna and Krishna. And it really brought home to me the power of reciting Bhagavad Gita and remembering these instructions. Prabhupada was so fond of this, he gave instructions that we should recite a chapter every day. It frees you from seva aparad, and it'll help you remember verses and so many things. He was very fond of this. And of course, Krishna also says whoever distributes this knowledge is my dearest servant. So just this principle of that you brought up and very successfully, I want to thank you for that. Sanjay, he's not even there. He's virtually there. But because he's actually associating with the sound vibration, he's experiencing transcendental ecstasy. That's available for us too.
That's true. Thank you. You know, the Sanjaya's verses in the Bhagavad Gita in the conclusion are very significant. If you see, the Bhagavad Gita ends at 73, but there are 5 full verses. Now, in 700 verses, 5 verses is not a very small number. It is a significant number. And when the Bhagavad Gita is given to us, we could have clipped off. The acharyas could have clipped off the 5 verses also, but they don't do that. Because that demonstrates the potency of the Gita, as you rightly pointed out, in transforming our hearts internally. So I have a whole class on just those 5 verses, 74 to 78. Each verse has its own significance. 74th verse is just, he's appreciating the fortune in hearing the Gita. 75th verse is acknowledgement of gratitude to Vyasadeva, by whose mercy he is able to hear this message. 76th is, he is not just appreciating the Gita, but he is remembering the Gita and relishing the Gita. And the how the 77th verse talks about how the philosophy leads to the personality. Sometimes people feel that, somebody will say, I just want to like to hear Leela, I want to have Rasa. I want to hear Bhagavatam, Chaitanya Charan. Bhagavad is too philosophical, it's dry for me. But remembering the words of the Gita reminds Sanjay of the speaker of the Gita. So how philosophy leads to personality, that's just signified from the 76th to 77th verse. This last verse talks about how there is victory, wherever there's Krishna and Arjuna there. So in that sense, each of these verses have very great significance, which reflect the potency of the Gita as it is manifest in the heart and the consciousness of Sanjay. Thank you. So thank you very much. Srimad Bhagavad Gita ki, Shri Prabhupada ki, Gaur Bhakta Vrinda ki, Gaur Premanande.